impact on the way that we share information with people, the tools that we share them with, right, if they're on a mobile phone or whatever that looks like. So it has a significant impact. Our vision as a company is to be the world's favorite travel company. So this is a list of the brands that we actually have 18 brands, but I didn't make that connection until I was sitting here, I'm only 16, but I was looking at it a few minutes ago. So there's two that are missing, I'm not sure which two they are. But we have 18 brands, with the most recent brand that we've launched over in the bottom right-hand corner called Moxie, which is a lifestyle brand that just opened in Milan, Italy earlier this month. Over the years, Marriott has been moving away from any hotel, any businesses that don't align with the lodging and the hotel business model. Marriott considers itself a global citizen. We work very hard to share the Marriott culture story in the communities and the business environments where we work, really trying to do a tremendous job of making a positive impact on the communities that we work. For those of you who don't know, the two folks in the middle are the Marriott, Mr. and Mrs. Marriott, and Richard Marriott is the gentleman just to the right. There are Marriott people. They are, for our first time in our company's history, we actually don't have a Marriott running the organization. It was brought in from outside about 20 years ago, is now leading the company. A couple of the things that we do, just from a positive impact to our community's lens, is if you're familiar with a gentleman named Yao Ming, former NBA star, we're building schools in China in partnership with the Yao Foundation. We're helping indigenous people in the Amazon rainforest to understand sustainable forestry so that they don't have a negative impact on the world's climate. Over the last 20 years, we've helped about 100,000 kids through a program we call Bridges move from, at-risk kids, at-risk youth, move from school to meaningful employment in the lodging and hotel industry. So we work very hard to do those types of things. The global growth and the pace of change we go through really pushes on that and makes it hard for us at times. You know, we're working with new countries, new people that may not have any history or context of what Marriott stands for and the way that we want to do business. And at times that presents challenges, and we'll talk through that a little bit. Very quickly, just a little bit more about Marriott. The way that we work is there's about 4,000 hotels today. There's a combination of managed units and franchise units. You really should know the difference when you stay at one of our hotels. The difference really is who the people work for at that hotel. It's the same procedures, the same standards. They should be doing all the same things. It's really just a question of what company they work for. And as you would expect, just like the bringing new hotels into the system, we also have a process for if people aren't meeting the standards that we have as a company to divest and remove them from the company. Marriott is an award-winning employer, consistently recognized as one of the top employers in the world. This is sort of the obligatory Marriott stuff, so I apologize. but it does paint a good picture. Some of the awards that are most relevant to the work that we do in this discussion, it's one of the 100 best companies to work for from a working mother's perspective, consistently recognized on Forbes Best Places to Work, and most recently, which is a shocker that I was sort of amazed that we won this award, is the 14th most innovative company in the world on Forbes 100 most innovative companies. So there's a lot of great stuff that happens, and I'm going to focus really just on the internet pieces. Over the years, we've owned a variety of businesses. Just down the road, I think the 49ers moved and built a stadium. It's next to Great America. That used to be a Marriott property. Over the years, as I mentioned, we've divested ourselves of all the businesses that really don't support the lodging industry. Here's a few more brands that you may be familiar with. I think three of them are still around. I don't think Hot Shops is there anymore. But these are all brands that Marriott created and then divested ourselves of as we focused on the lodging space. We even own a cruise line. One of the great things about Marriott is over the years is there's a great associate discount, so you can go places for a reasonably great rate. This was gone before I got into the company, but I heard it was primarily backed with associates, which is why they got rid of it. So Marriott's vision as a company, I already touched on, is be the world's favorite travel company. We really execute that through it's an evolving strategy year over year, as you would expect, but really focusing on this lower quadrant, which is what we call the four M's, which is gonna drive a lot of what I'm gonna talk to you about. First, Marriott hotels. We have about 700 Marriott big box hotels, kind of like this building around the world, that drives a tremendous amount of Marriott's revenue and profits. Making sure that those hotels are on brand, on message, thinking about one of the M's up there, I think the The last one, millennial mindset, is delivering against what those next generation of travelers expect when they check into hotels. Mobile, obviously you know where that's at, and also Marriott Rewards. Marriott Rewards is, and along with Ritz-Carlton Rewards, is the largest guest recognition program customer recognition program in the world with about 45 million members. Okay, last Marriott slide. This paints a really good picture. Marriott is laser focused on unit growth and increasing shareholder value. Over the last 7 years, an 85-year-old company has gone from, let me say it a different way. We've added 1,000 hotels in the last 7 years. The pace of change that we're moving forward with for every week for the next 5 years is 5 hotels per week. So over the next 5 years, we're going to add 1,300 hotels into our portfolio. And over a 12-year period, we've basically doubled the size of what Marriott was. So the systems and the processes that we put in place have to flex and support that. And that's what I'm going to be talking to you about and some of the processes that we do. One interesting, you know, sort of from a growth lens is Marriott recently, about a year ago, acquired a company called Protea. And Protea is the largest, was the largest hotel provider, hotelier in Africa. So with that change, you know, and this is sort of, we get about one of these a year, added 116 hotels, 16,000 employees across 16 different countries. And that's, you know, an example of the type of thing we deal with each year. All right, so these are the things that we're going to go over. And the focus that we took when putting this together for you is really focusing on what are some of the things that I wish somebody told me if I was sitting in the audience. So hopefully some of these things resonate with you. These are things that we do in the work that we do every day. So about 15 years ago, just tell you a little bit more about sort of Marriott's web experience. About 15 years ago, Marriott went on a journey of elimination of client server technology. You know, I'm sure we still have some, right? Everybody has Outlook installed on their desktops, but anything that's built today that's gonna support a business process or is purchased from a vendor perspective is really web enabled. It's part of a single sign-on system that we have. So when people come into our web space, we're able to understand their relationship to Marriott. Are they an owner, a franchisee, vendor, contractor? And then target the content towards them or target the role within that system based on what it is that they need. That environment, you know, when we talk about the cloud, there's a lot of discussions. I think every discussion has a cloud theme. Marriott sort of has its own cloud in the sense that we have this globally available extranet that with that any device and that login ID you can get to from wherever you might be located around the world. We are very interested in the cloud, and we'll talk about how we can potentially leverage that in a little bit. So this is what Marriott Global Source looks like, sort of working from left to right. We've got our front door. This is what people see when they launch Internet Explorer after they've logged in, and our new search experience. It's a fourth generation internet. We started about 15 years ago with the Encompass product set, which is purchased by Microsoft, became Microsoft Content Management Server. Microsoft Content Management Server sort of merged into a SharePoint combination, and over the last couple of years, we've moved to the Alfresco platform. It's evolved from a site where, and I've got a picture on this a little bit later, it's evolved from a site of 22 independently maintained sites, a site for a Courtyard hotel, a site for food and beverage, site for owners, where that was a site that was maintained by about 300 different people who were content experts. They were great with the programs they needed to run, and they also had that web expertise. You know, as we built MGS, we moved to a model of inviting them to uninvite themselves from some of those responsibilities, and now they focus on content. And the team that I work as part of has the content management, the web design, web generalists that really focus on how to present that information and not on what the content is. It's the primary access point for all of Marriott's enterprise-enabled or those EID-enabled processes or systems. The current system, which you see here, has been in place for about 2 years, and the new search experience launched about 3 months ago, or 2 or 3 months ago. The MGS story is probably similar to your own intranet stories in that it really is all about helping people do the work that they need to do to create great experiences for our guests. So speaking of our employees, here's a few of them. We have 300,000 people that have a relationship to Marriott that could potentially use our systems. Owners, franchisees, vendors, contractors. almost 250,000 of them, I think we're going to reach 250,000, 250,000 of those people log into MGS each year. We get about 120,000 of those, 230,000 month over month, and depending on the day of the week, somewhere between 20 and 25,000 people that log into our site. I had a question and someone at lunch today, they asked how many Alfresco users we have. We actually only have about 10 people that actually touch the content and access through the interfaces that we leverage from Crafter. So it's a very, very big difference as far as the model, as far as where we manage content. It's considered a mission critical system. You know, in the untimely event of something that would, you know, happen that would take down our systems, you know, there's, you know, I'm sure we all have business continuity processes that we work within. MGS is brought up before email when it comes to Marriott. It is where people would expect to go to find out about what they should be doing and what we're doing about it and how we're supporting them. I was looking at this earlier and I realized I should have put new pictures in here. These are clearly not our pictures, right? Point being, we have a lot of stuff. MGS has about 12,000 pages of information, and it's a living, breathing entity as far as the amount of change and stuff that goes in and goes out on a daily basis. It consists of web pages that tell people how to do everything from make a bed to where to buy shampoo to, you know, deploy a new sales and marketing program. About 30% of the content on MGS is updated every 90 days. 35% of the content is purged every year, year over year. We always seem to end back at about this 12,000 number. We have a request process, and I'll talk a little bit about that later, where people ask us to do stuff. That could be add a file, could be change a web page, could be build a new brand into the system. We get about 3,000 of those a month. And then we also have somewhere over the year, somewhere between 5 and 7 new major content projects, which is add a brand or, in many cases, remove a brand, which can be just as complex as adding a brand. 200,000 documents. This is a huge opportunity area for us. We do not have, and we do not use Alfresco's document management system. Why? I don't know. It's on the list of things that's on our radar screen to do, but we don't have that today. We have homegrown tools and processes to manage those documents. We actually found that when we built our new search interface, it was better for us to move documents out of search and give people web page context to navigate them to the documents that made sense. About 25% of these things change or get deleted each year, and we add on average about 40,000 new documents. So this number year over year, I think last year it was 180,000. So it seems to go up about 20,000 documents a year. So that's a great opportunity for us. So a little bit about the model that we have from a content management perspective. We that was a weird sound. That was my nice. Nobody back there. All right. What's a presentation without a distraction, right? So we have about 850 people. I'm going to ignore the voices in my head. Hopefully everybody's hearing that, right? I'll write back at you. All right, so we have about 850 people that we work with who are those content experts. They focus on the they focus on the content, the who, the what, not at all on the web presentation, the techniques or the tactics to maintain that content. As we look at the processes to support this global changing company, about 30% of those people change year over year. Right, so we have to have tools and processes to make it easy when we get 225 new people a year to get the need to communicate their stuff that new to Marriott that may not be in the United States and don't know who we are, and so that's a challenge for us. Uh-oh, I think I clicked something. Oh no, it changed. So this is my team. There's definitely an IT group that supports us for deploying new infrastructure, figuring out how to make a lot of the X's and O's work. I have a fantastic team. We've been together for about 7 years, the majority of the folks here, and they really focus on everything from day-over-day content management, search optimization, governance, audit, customer service, measurement, all those things that we do from an intranet perspective. These are the folks that do it at Marriott. One of the things that we try to do is content management. I don't know about in your work experience, but content management can be a tough job, right? It's sitting and looking at screens all day, thinking about content. How am I going to organize it? Each person on the team has an area that they specialize in and above content management. So we don't have one person that focuses only on search or focuses on audit. Each person has probably 75% of their time towards regular content management, and then 25% to support those other core areas that we do. So, yep. About 35, yep. Yep, so our CIO, that's a great question. I think the question was, do we have any automated processes and how do we manage that purging process? Our CIO a few years ago wanted literally a process where if a page was older than X days, he wanted his face to show up and say, sorry, it's been deleted. So you can't even go there anymore, it's been pulled down. Clearly we didn't do that. We actually have a manual process where we sit down face to face, and I'm gonna talk about that in a little bit in greater detail, but we sit down face to face or over the web with people that own that content required, and it's a rolling cycle. It takes us about 15 months to roll from beginning of the site to the end of the site. And so one of those people on the previous slide, that is their job. That's all they do, is they focus on ongoing reviews and purging. It's outside of search, and I'll touch on this later, it's the number one thing that people complain about. If you don't solve for deleting outdated stuff, you can't be successful, right? I mean, it's a huge problem. So, a couple of the key things, and you can see sort of the journey of our intranet site over the years, is that it's back. What we do is complex. I think often people think about the intranet space in the model that we have and think, we could distribute that. We could give those 850 people the ability to do stuff. And I think that would be underselling the value of what we do as a group. We can always get better. We're always trying to get better. It's interesting, as I sat there this morning listening to the general session and all the great things were being discussed, trying to figure out what's the one thing that we could do out of there, or what are the two things that we could potentially look at. There's so many things that you could do, but you can't do everything. And selection of those projects and where you're going to invest your time and money is key. And then lastly, the most important thing from my lens, based on the work that we've done, search is never good enough. No matter how much time you invest in it, everyone is unhappy with search, although we did make some significant improvements. This is not me, but a little bit about my role and sort of where we sit within the organization. I know in many companies, the content management team sits as part of HR. We're actually part of the global communications team. So my peers are folks that run the PR or corporate communications. We also have Marriott's graphic and design and production services. They produce events for Marriott. We partner with our business disciplines to ensure that what we're doing both today, a year from now, and 3 years from now is in sync with what they want to be achieving. My primary role day over day is to ensure that the news and business of Marriott is online, available, and current. So as you talk about the day over day, it's critically important to focus on what we're going to be doing. If you don't focus on the future and set aside time to think about what you're going to be doing, bringing in the right partners and having good discussions, we wouldn't be where we're at without the support of the vendors that we're using. We also give people goals that are focused on within my team that are focused on helping them relative to those things. I mean, when we went on the picture earlier, I said that people focus on other tasks. Those people have goals that are affiliated with making those individual items better. So the person who works on search, they have year-over-year goals that support search moving forward, or analytics, or whatever the focus area is. We spent a lot of time, probably more than we should, but we spent a lot of time thinking about what can we get better? What should we be doing? And we have a quarterly planning session. I shouldn't say planning because we don't really, it's a brainstorming session on what could we do? What should we be doing? What tools should we tweak? What should we purchase? What should we stop doing from a process perspective? And the outcome of that is we can't do all those things that come up in the discussion, but I think having the team participate in that process gets buy-in for some of the things that are eventually gonna get executed. And with everything we do, we're focused on our end users and delivering a better experience. Few things that keep me up at night relative to the work that we do and things that I think are really important. Marriott is a customer service organization. In a headquarters building, it has 2,000 people, probably 1,700 of them worked in a hotel. So they worked helping guests create great experiences. And if you ever stayed at a Marriott hotel, one of the things that you often hear is that people, they're just nice. They're just nice people who want to help. And I work with 1,700 of those people, and it's so hard not to meet their expectations because I know what their expectations are of our team, and that's a challenge for us. Not that we don't do it, but it's just knowing that we have a high bar to reach. The pace of change in the web has made it very hard for us to keep up with those demands and meeting their needs for what they're expecting us to do. Global growth, we've already touched on this, but the pace of change at Marriott is staggering at times. Our business model is very, very complex, and while it's considered as part of a transaction, when they decided to bring on those 116 hotels in Africa, they didn't think about how are we going to deliver the content to these people, and do we have the right content and the right language and the tools that they're going to be able to use, right? We have to react and adapt to that. Being a global company is different than operating globally. You simply don't know what you don't know, and that's been an interesting experience. One of the things that is important for us to understand in the future is that language is, as a company, our primary language that we offer our content in is English. I've yet to see, personally, any technology that is easy to use, expands to the level that we needed across 12,000 pages and 200,000 documents, and is affordable, right? That's sort of that's the holy grail of accomplishing that. So looking forward to learning more about that while I'm here. Software development projects is a huge deal for us. I think that somewhere between the impact of mobile on this is we've added 40 to 50% to our overall project costs to just build things that are mobile friendly. We had years of being, we only support Internet Explorer version X. Well, we can't do that anymore, right? People, that's not good enough. So that's caused a lot of challenges for us. We tend to do a lot of stuff based on versioning. So version one of something, version two, that lets us get stuff out faster. It also doesn't work for some of your bigger bang projects where you just have to bite the bullet and roll things out in a big bang, which comes with more risk. And for us, we found that choosing a right partner has been very helpful for getting those tools out there quickly with little impact on bringing our production environment down because of the number of people that can currently use it. And we think we've got the right team with the Rivet Crafter partnership. So touching on what you'd asked earlier a little bit about, so outdated content, it's a huge problem, right? If we don't solve for this, and we haven't solved for it, but we have lots of processes that support trying to solve it, but it still is just a tremendous issue. We have a number of strategies. As we build and grow around the globe, probably one of the biggest issues is, as a company, we're focused on building new stuff, rolling out new tools, rolling out new programs, and it's very hard to get that person that's responsible for the new food and beverage promotion that's gonna launch over the winter to focus on the stuff that's still up there, that still isn't working, or it might have changed, or it's a new vendor supplied X. So that's hard to get time and attention to focus on that. But that's a key issue. And obviously, for those of you who don't know, it's Donald Rumsfeld. He's famous for saying the things that I don't know about, right? In a world of Marriott where it's globally distributed, newly empowered continental leadership, spirit of innovation where people are being asked to innovate and do things, coupled with an IT group who wants to empower and enable everybody to do everything, maybe not understanding how all those things connect back to what we're trying to do from a strategy perspective, it makes life pretty interesting. One of the things that I think is I'm a big NNG fan. I don't know if you're familiar with the Nielsen Norman group, but they do a lot of stuff around intranets and best practices. And there's so many great, they have a weekly newsletter. And it's sort of what I look to every Monday morning to help me inform what are some things that we could be doing that maybe we're not. But there are just, the reason I mention it is there's just so many good ideas of things that you could do. Not all of them are gonna work for your organization. And many of them, either can't be done or it doesn't make sense to do. In our world, there's a lot of stakeholders who give us input on what they'd like to see us do. And what we try to look at is what do they want us to do? What is industry doing as a whole as far as best practices and consultants and leadership? And what do some of the peers that we have, I have some peers at different organizations that I talk to, and what are they doing? And look to that sort of trifecta of inputs to help us inform the things that we're gonna do and hopefully learn from some of the challenges that they faced along the way. So our philosophy, we doing okay? I'm gonna get a quick drink of water here. So some of our core philosophies as far as how we, and I'm a walker, so I apologize. I know I keep going back and forth, but I couldn't figure out how to get back to the slides. Our philosophy from a content management perspective, we talked about a large population of people, that has a 30% turnover every year. We have to make it simple and easy and fast for them to get what they need done communicated. They have to feel like we're an extension of their team, or they'll find a different way, right? There was a lot of talk this morning about adoption of different technologies, and I've rolled out a content management system and people aren't using it. We're sort of in a benefit in that we don't really have that. We have a corporate intranet. It's where people are expected to do stuff, but there's always people out there that want to do something. They buy a piece of technology that does X and it has these other five things that comes with it. So it's important for us to make it feel like we're responsive, able to help, and we can do it better, faster, cheaper than they can do it if they try to do it themselves. And it allows them to focus on their core work. We measure the stuff that we think is important, and if we don't measure it, we probably shouldn't be doing it. And we measure a lot of stuff, but there's a lot of things people do that we don't necessarily need to be doing. We work closely with our global business units, and I do think this is something that we're winning at. A lot of people ask me how they don't understand how we take that model and we make it successful, and I don't understand from the way that we operate globally, where we've taken people and said, okay, go out there and run this, but we then expect it to be consistent to be successful as a company without having this in place. Key metrics around content management. Can I defer that question to the end, and then I'll come back to it? Because I want to make sure I get through some stuff, but I have some very specifics on that. And I'll touch on that when we get to search. Actually, I'll share some of the key metrics. So we talked about this, keeping content fresh. People can always request at any point in time, go into a forum, tell us what it is that they need, and we'll make that happen. A couple other things that we do is, above and beyond that, we have a dedicated person who every 15 months sort of works through the site. And we reorganize or reprioritize that person's work based on what's going on in the company. If there's a restructuring in IT, then they readjust and they focus on the IT area right after that change has happened. We also look at the most used pages on our website. So the top 100 pages account for about 30% of our overall traffic, right? Super high value pages, 20,000 people, a couple million page views. Those 100 pages are really key. So we look at those pages month over month from a quality perspective, from a currency perspective, from a design perspective, is the right stuff there? But I think you have to keep content fresh. One of the things that we do, just as an aha, is we try and avoid things like the worst. We don't use dates. We don't use the word new. We don't use last updated. Right? Because if someone gets to a page and you see something like that, it instantly feels outdated when that isn't something that's today or yesterday. So we try to avoid all those things that make something feel like they might not be current. The ability to find information on our site can be tough. Search is a great way to solve that now. We have a very deep and very wide site. It's easy to say, but harder to do. You probably see this in your work. We have a lot of people who develop a program, and they want whatever that program catchy name is, that's what they want to be in the IA, that's what they want to be on the page. And the reality is people don't understand that. It makes it harder for people to get to and find their information. So we work and push back really hard on things that aren't process-driven as opposed to a catchy name, if that makes sense. Really focused on improving the user experience. Simple statement, very hard to do. That was another big theme that I heard this morning from the general session, as well as the first session that I sat in here earlier today. It was from the Gartner gentleman, was focus on user experience. All we do is try to focus on improving the user experience. And there's a lot of great ways to do that. Our goal is to prevent great-looking pages that are readable at an eighth-grade level. We have a wide variety of user base, everyone from someone who's might have just joined and they're an assistant housekeeper through the CEO, CIO, and everything in between, tens and tens of thousands of people, everything focused at an eighth-grade level. Say it again?
Do you localize?
Localize, we do not. We do not. That is an opportunity area for us, though. So we don't do. Let me come back to that. I'm going to touch on that in a second. Anybody have right here. So we also try to align with what people's experience is on the internet today, right? So we want to make it feel like a modern website, and that's hard, right? When you have 12,000 pages, do some things with CSS occasionally to try and tweak some things. But targeted content is a huge opportunity for us, right? So I think that's what you were thinking about localization. So in the world of Marriott, it's not so much geographic location that's important. What's important is your relationship to Marriott and the brand that you work for. So if you're a Residence Inn general manager, and I'll use this example as we go through, if you're a Residence Inn general manager, there's 600 people that have that same job. So focusing you on the things that apply to Residence Inn and getting the Courtyard stuff away and the Marriott stuff away and the Ritz-Carlton stuff away really helps improve your experience. And we think by doing some targeting and doing some localization of content that we can actually eliminate 50% of what you have access to and decrease the amount of time it takes for you to get to something by 75%. Right? So that's a big priority for us and for 2015. Philosophy, very quickly through these things. Want to be relevant. You know, if we're not connected to our associates, owners, and franchisees, we're gonna fail. Mobile everything, right? This is a big priority for us. I'm gonna move through some of these a little quickly so I can get my mic up here. You asked about measurement. We do a lot of stuff around measurement. Outside of the general stuff, which you would expect, we do focus a lot on what our content owners think, what our end users think about the things that we've tested and deployed. We do a lot of testing before we roll out technology on a sample of pages. Invariably what happens is if we don't do that, we'll put something on a page and then 50 requests will come in to do that thing, and we don't know if that thing actually works well yet. So that's an area where we spend a lot of time in measurement. And then last thing here, then I'm going to turn it over to Mike and then I'll come back up. A couple of statements that sort of employ sort of the way that we think about the work that we do. I'm just going to leave these up for 2 or 3 seconds each. You can just sort of read through those. All right, I'm going to skip through the challenges, Mike, I think. And I'd like you to come on up if that's okay. Just while you're coming up, some of the things that, from a very high-level perspective that we're challenged with is cost, right? And so we've got a couple slides here that deal with cost. And we think cost and flexibility are probably a good way to say that. And we think that the cloud solution is potentially something that can have a significant impact for us on those two areas. So we'll jump here. And I'm going to go back to search, actually, after you're up. Oh, there you go. Thank you, Mike.
Great. Let me hear.
Oh, I think it's right. Thank you. I think it says on the bottom.
Thanks, Eric. And I'll just briefly give you some perspective on Marriott's CMS selection. They engaged with us back in 2010. They had already purchased Alfresco, had selected it as their primary enterprise CMS for this application. And the architecture, going back to their first generation, as Eric mentioned, was Microsoft-based system, Microsoft CMS, and they had selected Alfresco given its new architecture and agility and frameworks for supporting this type of use case. They evaluated a variety of proprietary systems, all the usual suspects, as well as other open source platforms, and ended up with our help using Crafter and Alfresco. Crafter CMS, for those of you that don't know, is a full web CMS capability built on top of Alfresco and provides support for rich authoring tools, which is what Eric and his team use to author the content, manage all the content, preview that content, and then publish it out to all of their users, which is then consumed by a separate application. Supports complex workflows and provides support within the authoring environment for scripting capabilities. So not just the business users, but what we generally refer to as web ninjas, those that know web scripting capabilities can update templates and develop rich experiences right on the front end within the tool and without having to redeploy code. So the implementation here, we only have a couple minutes here, so We're going to just briefly go through this here with starting with their content providers submitting content and requests to the centralized team, which then goes through the workflow processes, the preview, and then out to the actual MGS intranet application. And the implementation architecture, as shown here, here on the left, we have the content authors and managers that all go through their single sign-on solution, coming into Crafter Studio, which is the authoring application, which sits on top of the Alfresco platform. So all content is stored within Alfresco. And then with references to MarDocs, which is, again, as Eric mentioned, currently is their document repository that, that is currently outside of Alfresco, but one day we'll, we think we'll be inside Alfresco. And then all of the content, including the documents and all of the MGS application, the pages and the experiences that are personalized for all of these different users, the 200 plus thousand users come through Crafter Engine and the MGS application, which sits on top of it. So I think we'll wrap it up here with a little bit of what's next from Eric's perspective.
Thank you. I may jump back just to show you something I think is, they gave me, they said we had 5 extra minutes because we have some time in between. I want to show you just what we did around our search experience. I think this cuts a little bit of the metrics. Go back a little further. So we spent a major amount of time, probably the biggest project that we've done in the last couple of years outside of the migration to Alfresco and the various upgrades within that space are to improve our search experience. And you know, it's by far the number one thing that people were commenting or complaining about. And if you remember the phrase from Bill Clinton back in the, or from one of the presidents back in the early 90s, it's the economy, stupid. Search is that type of important, at least from a Marriott perspective. And this dog has become wildly popular. This is our search mascot, I think. So you can see what our search experience was like, right? Back from something that creating my own series of sounds here, sorry. Back from something that was built by a technologist to our second generation to what we have today. And not surprisingly, when we did research and asked people what they wanted, they said, make it look like Google, right? So that's for the most part what we did. We have a mobile and tablet friendly and obviously desktop friendly Google inspired interface with type ahead, a lot of new capabilities for us where you can search by things based on revise, date, maybe location, geographic location, also language. We also did a lot of tuning on our relevancy model. And the three things that relative to the metrics that I think are important related to this at a very high level is that since this change, so imagine 20,000, it's about 25,000 people a month, that use search. About 50% of our audience in general uses search. But we used to have an experience where we had 20 things that would come back. Now we have an experience where you have 10 to choose from. Of those 10 things, 98% of all the things people could look for, 98% of the people don't go to page 2. 98% of the people are clicking something in that first page of results. 82% of the people are clicking something that's in the first 3. Right? So it's been a tremendous success. And of about 1,200 people that responded to a survey that we put out about this, rated the search experience as a 4 or 5 out of five score. So just a tremendous thing. And when we post the slides, there's a video that we've produced that talks about search. It's about 3 minutes. It gives you a good idea of sort of what we've done. So let me jump to the other things, being sensitive of time and wanting to allow a few minutes for questions. So as you look to the future, share with you a couple of the bigger things, which are probably very aligned with some of the things that you've heard from the general session today and some things you may be considering. Cheaper, faster, more flexible, right? We think that there's a tremendous opportunity to take our infrastructure, which is costly and expensive to maintain and upgrade and migrate. From a Marriott perspective, it's not related to software costs, it's related to just the way that we charge internally for things. I think there's a tremendous opportunity to move to the cloud and look at cost savings, which would also allow us to as I think someone used the term earlier, sort of, I can't remember what the word was, but basically do small incremental changes that we would just be able to take advantage of because the cloud is always being upgraded to the latest version of the software. have to figure out new ways to deliver content. Our MGS experience is 100% available on your phone, and it basically takes that same screen and just shrinks it down to something that's really small and impossible to read unless you like expand, and it's not a great experience. You can use it, but today, I think we have about 12%, somewhere in 10 or 12% of our folks actually use MGS on a mobile phone, compared to most of our other systems, which are just skyrocketing from a mobile perspective. So huge opportunity there. Thoughtful language support, we've already talked about this. If there's someone out there that has a solution that's cheap, scalable, and is easy to implement and support, I would love to know about it. That's something that we struggle with. We know a lot about people who use our site. I think I touched on this earlier, but we really want to get into more focused content, not just you as general manager, but you as the general as an associate, but you as a general manager of Residence Inn, and here's the stuff that could apply to you. We touched on how that could have an impact. So this is an interesting one for us, in just like two or three more slides, in that for lots of reasons, Marriott can't turn on social technology that says, Eric thinks this. Just can't do it as a business. It presents some legal and other issues related to that. What we can do is we could say, the general manager for Residence Inn is looking at these types of things. Oh, and by the way, all of the general managers that work for Residence Inn are looking at these things. So we think there's an opportunity to use social from the perspective of driving trends and informing the content that we present to people on a very generic level, kind of like when you search for something and those things that are more popular come up. We think it makes sense that we can actually use your role and your relationship to Marriott to elevate that and to present content. I think it's a potentially tremendous win for us. Document management, we've already talked about that, super important. And then ironically, lastly, this is a huge theme from this morning, right, was simplify. I did not change this. This is what we had to start off with here. And this is such a hard thing to do. There's no magic button that just says, get rid of that and simplify. And but for our space, what we found is by doing many little things to simplify, whether it's a process or retiring a tool, the more little things you can do, the simpler things get in aggregate, and that can help a lot. And the very last thing before we go to questions, if there are any, is we have over in our office space a word cloud that represents the things that we're trying to do through the interactions that we present online. I just wanted to share that with you, which are some of the key words that we try to focus on. So in our environment, our content owners, those people that are in the building, come to our offices, or we go to them, they usually come to us, and sit down side by side with us and sort of work on their content and manage it. And so these are some of the things that we try to instill upon in the work that we do. So that's it as far as the actual discussion and things that I was going to cover. Thank you very much for your time. Happy to try and address any questions. Actually, maybe we'll go back to the analytics question. So we do a lot of stuff to understand where people are going, how they go there, primarily from the lens of where we're going to focus our efforts in content cleanup, right? With 12,000 pages, lots of review going on those pages. I touched on earlier, we focus on what are those top 100 things and optimizing those experiences. And we actually also look at, in that sense, from a search lens, we look at what are the top 200 things that people look for? What do associates look for? I think someone mentioned that earlier today as well in the general session, and sort of getting deeper and understanding not the numbers, getting deeper in the numbers, sort of understanding what that means. And, I think we have about, I want to say it's 300,000 unique searches that go on in our site a month. And I'm going to be off by a number here, so I apologize, but I think that the top 100 searches account for like 60%. I mean, the exact match that people are looking for. So we really focus hard to make those things that we know people are looking at, because we got lots of data to tell us, to optimize those experiences. And then we measure, all the things that you would typically measure. So does that answer your question? Was there something specific you were trying to get at, or no? Okay. Other questions? Okay, we're done. Thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it.